Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen. You're watching one of the very last episodes of Programming with Qt and QML. In the previous three episodes in this module, we've been building up to this moment where you now will be able to create new elements that will paint themselves. So up until this point in your career, you have been creating new elements in QML by taking rectangles and text elements and whatnot and putting them together into new QML files and naming that new QML file, say lineedit.qml, and then you could use a lineedit element. But you would be very, very hard at work if you were to create a list view, for example, from scratch, without using the list view, but only using composition of new elements like this. That would very likely not be very efficient, at least, and you would definitely have problems with the events and so on. We're going to see that in this particular video, not a list view, that would be too ambitious, but we'll see how we can create new visual elements and how we handle events on those visual elements. You have three options whenever you create new visual elements. The first one is this painted item. So it's a subclass of QQuick painted item. That's the one we're going to see in this video. It says potentially slower up here. I'd like you to put it this way. The other two options that we're not going to cover in this video series at all, because they are really, really advanced options. The next one where you subclass from QQuick item directly and set up the scene graph yourself, is easily weeks of work to get right. The QQuick painted item, depending on what you need, of course, you might be able to get that working in a day. So weeks versus days, I would personally always go initially with the QQuick painted item, see how it works. If it turns out that it's really lacking and I don't get my 60 frames a second that I was hoping for and so on, that's when I'll invest in rewriting it to use just QQuick. QQuick item subclass directly from that and set up my notes using update paint node. It's possible to integrate raw QML into your QML scene, raw OpenGL into your QML scene. So if you have something else that produces raw OpenGL, could be say a map widget or map, whatever that's called, that was already in existence and you just need to integrate it into your QML scene, that is perfectly okay too. But well, now we're definitely in the land of very advanced stuff. In any case, what you need is still to export your objects from C++ using what we saw in the previous video. Anything that we talked about with signals and slot and properties and QInvocable and all of that stuff still applies. So let's see a symbol object. This symbol object is an ellipse, and well, that is indeed a very simple object. But the thing about it is, if you had, say, a dial or something that was too complex to be just composed by images and the other elements that you have in QML, then you could go down on the C++ level and create that new element. So I have an ellipse item. It's subclassing from QQuick painted item. QObjects, we've seen that many times before. I set up my properties for that particular item. In this case, I'm just making it possible to change the color of it from the QML scene. I set up my constructor and I override this virtual method that is called paint. Paint takes a QPainter. This is my QPainter. It's something that I can draw just like you would draw on a piece of paper. So it has a number of facilities built in. You can draw single dots, you can draw lines, you can draw ellipses, you can draw images. Well, I would definitely not do that myself with this kind of painter, but that's your QPainter API. The actual painting, well, it's rather simplified on the slide here. I will, in this method, on that painter, call some method that will do the painting. Let's see the code. That was the wrong one. I clicked that. Let's see the code in action. That will give us an idea of what the painting API really looks like. So I have this new element called ellipse item. I register it with QML with QML register type, shapes 1.0, and it's called ellipse. So actually, this is an example where ellipse and ellipse item is not the same name. I show my application, I do all those things that we've seen so many times before on my QML side. I instantiate an ellipse. I anchor it inside its parent, just like I would anchor a rectangle or I'd anchor a text element or whatever. I give it some margin, 50 pixels of margin here. I give it the color blue. And then I set up a timer that says after 2000 milliseconds, it should actually change to red. That's what you see here. So 2000 milliseconds, there will be a timeout where ellipse.color is equal to red, just to show you that I can access the visible component part of it from QML to modify what it looks like generated on the C++ side. Let's look at my ellipse item on the C++ side. It's subclassing, as we saw on the slide, QQuick painted item. It has this property set up for the color. It has this paint method that we need to do. Color and set color is just used for my changing the color via the property here. And it has the color as an instance value. And here's the code for the painting of the item. But let's go down and look at the set color right away. So whenever I'm on the QML side, set the color, I do this pattern that we've seen before, and super important that we check, did it actually change? If not, then don't do anything. So if the color is different from what it was already, then set the color, emit the color change, and I call update. See, I am not in control of when the pixels will be put on the screen. All I can do, I now am the C++ object here that we are implementing. All that C++ object can do is to tell QML, hey, I have changed. You might want to come around and ask me for repainting myself again. That's what the update method does. So calling update here result in paint being executed. I do paint a save and paint a restore. I'll tell you about those in just a few seconds. I set the brush. So that's a QPen. I'll set the brush to be whatever color I had, 3 pixels thick. And then I set the pen on the painter. I ask I want to figure out what the size should be. So I create this rectangle here, painter rect. It takes 2 parameters. It takes a Q point F. That is a default constructed Q point F. That is just 0, 0. And then it takes the size. And that is my width and height of the element itself. So QML on the QML side, we saw that I created my element, I anchored it, and anchoring it, that resulted in the size of the QQuick item being set, and I can go and ask for the size using this method. There's a tiny little thing about our painter that's important to understand here. That is, when I draw, say, an ellipse, then where is that ellipse located inside width times height amount of pixels? Well, the border, the line of it, is 0.5 pixel on each side of the area that I would be drawing on. So that means that I actually need to, if I want to draw on 20 times 10, then I actually need to limit it a bit in, otherwise I'll be painting outside of that bounding rectangle. So that's what I do here. I'm adjusting it 1 pixel in on each of the sides so that I have my border of my painted ellipse inside the bounding rings. I draw on my ellipse and then the save and the restore. See, if QML were to paint 20 elements using QPainter, it wouldn't create a new one every time. It would just give it to me and say, hey, can you paint with this painter? Then one object would paint and it would take the painter again, give it to another one, can you paint? So therefore I cannot change the state of the painter in between because other elements that come after me might be changed then. So that's why I do the save and the restore. In this very particular example, it would likely have been just as easy to just remember the pen and then set the pen back. But I could have done more generic transformations. I could have done, well, rotating and zooming and so on that QPainter, which is in the API for QPainter. And had I done that, I would definitely need to go back to the previous one. That's what the save and restore does. So in general, just remember always do the save and restore and then you're home safe. And if your profiler tells you, hey, it's that particular element that takes a lot of energy when you paint, then you can go and look into alternatives. That was our element. That's how I can paint my element. Let me go to the slides again, because the next topic we have here is how about events? Again, imagine that you were to implement a list view, right? And you only had QML side to do it. You could likely have your repeater and a column create your elements there. But then how about the swiping in the list view? You'd have to put those together with a mouse area that was listening to swipe and whatnot. That would be a lot of work. You can do event handling on the C++ side. And the way that it works on the C++ side is that there is a virtual method on QQuick item, and remember QQuick painted item is subclass in QQuick item. There's a virtual method called event, and given events, or whenever an event comes to you, it will be called. And it will take a Q event pointer in, and that Q event is then what is telling what kind of event and everything. The nice people at Nokia, when they implemented this, they had the idea, well, you're likely going to override a number of different events. You're going to override mouse event and well, mouse press and mouse release and so on. So rather than you write a 2,000 line long event method where you say, if the event type is mouse press and do this, if it's mouse release and do that, rather than you have all those if tests in there, they actually give you a default implementation of QQuick item events, and that default implementation does exactly those tests. So it tests if it's a mouse press, then call another virtual method called mouse press event. If it's a mouse release, call another virtual method called mouse release. If it's a whatever, whatever, then call another virtual method. So there already exists a number of virtual methods, and you likely would want to override those instead of overriding the event method. But there's not virtual method for everything in there. So if something comes around where there is no virtual method for that, then you can always override the event. But do remember to call the superclasses event, because otherwise, well, those virtual methods wouldn't be called. Let's see this in action here for our example again. So we got the ellipse once again. The ellipse looks like this now. I click on it, and every time I click on it, it changes the color. So it's an ellipse on steroids. And I can use the wheel here to change the color just slightly. So I'm scrolling the wheel as you're looking at this. Okay. This is same as before. I'm now at version 5.0 of my ellipse, obviously. But let's look at the ellipse class here. The only change there is to the ellipse compared to what you had before is that I now override this mouse event here, and I override, or mouse press event, and I override the wheel event. So if we look at those two, my mouse press event simply set the color to a random color, and set color is the one that updates the color and emits the color change. And the random color is just a method that returns me a random color based on some magic here. The wheel event is checking the events delta. So I scroll the wheel and see if I can show you my little mouse here. I scroll the wheel just a little bit, and the delta actually tells me in degrees how many degrees it has scrolled. And if I scroll it one way, it's going to be positive. If I scroll it the other way, it's going to be a negative number. So I test whether I'm scrolling it in the one way, and then I made the color lighter. Otherwise, I make it the color darker. And the API for lighter and darker is the most horrendous API in the whole of Qt. So I'll not even try to explain that to you. Just go and look it up. That's actually it. We now seen how we handle events. So we could ourselves implement something similar to the list view, where we were listening to all the events involved in implementing a list view. And we would have an element from the C++ side into QML that could do exactly like list view. I think it would still be quite a bit of a challenge to implement a list view, but I'll end this whole module about how we create new elements and how we integrate from the C++ to QML side. I'll end that by showing you a bit of gamma ray. So let me see if I can find a shell here. Shell, and I'll just start gamma ray. Gamma ray comes up and asks me, do you really dare gamma ray to do stuff in your system? I say, yeah, sure. I need my application running too, by the way. So run my application. And now my gamma ray will see that application here. Yes, that's the one. Gamma ray starts up. Let's just go full screen with gamma ray. And what I'd like to show you is something that, at least to me, at the time I'm recording this video, is a brand new feature in gamma ray, namely events. So up here, I can see all the events that go through that system. And you can see there's quite a bit of events that is not mouse press and mouse release. So it's actually pretty nifty to go and look at this to get an idea of what's going on. See, I just added my, I just showed my ellipse there, and all of a sudden I got new events there. There's a timer event, an enter event, an input method event, and so on. And I'm moving the mouse around and you see lots of events flying by. A useful thing is to go here in types, and let me just show none. Well, record none. There we go. And then let's go and look for the wheel event. Wheel, this one, record and show that. And then go back over here to my lock, and I take my element here and move my cursor on top of the text, and I rotate my wheel just once. And you can see this is what happens whenever I rotate my wheel on the text part of this ellipse. So first of all, my QQuick view was the one that got the event. My QQuick view was the one that's figured out which element is really in here. Well, it's the QQuick text that sits inside here. Okay, so that one is definitely not going to be able to handle it. So it propagate up to the parent element, namely the ellipse element. And I can see all the details of the event here. I can see that the delta was 120. The global position of my cursor on my screen was 969,519. Modifiers, no modifiers. So it didn't hold down. Let me try that. Press down the control key now and rotate. And this time, my ellipse item is this one here. You can see that the modifiers, the control modifier, was held down. So there's a lot of information to be gathered about events, super useful when you start working with new elements that has a UI from the C++ side. Simply not do what I did here and make all the events go away. Record all of them, show all of them, and go over in the log. And you can, whatever you do, you can see, oh, so there's actually an event for this or that coming in. And then you can start reacting on that event to do exactly what you need to do. Now you know everything. Well, that would be an exaggeration. You know a lot about how you create new elements from the QML side, from the C++ side into the QML side. As I said, there are more power if you really find that the QQuick painted item is too slow. Hey, I know a company that actually do services that might help you with that. We can't give away everything for free, right? So do reach out to us if it turns out that your elements are too slow. We might help you set up the scene graph based ones instead. Until we see next time, and when we see next time, we'll talk about models from C++ to QML. Until we see, have a great day.